the times of that basically will not be covered after, or because she's out of town, aren't in the bulletin. So if you need anything, please feel free to reach out to us, or anybody on council. And then keep in mind, we're getting into November now, November quilting dates, All Saints Sunday, Bible studies, and then of course daylight savings time. All of those things are listed in the bulletin. Please just make sure that you kind of note that on your schedules as well. On the heels of that, keep in mind that November is Thanksgiving blessing time. Coming up here Sunday, November 3rd, we're asking for cans of vegetables or stews. So if you look in there, if everyone brings one item, think of the impact that can make. Just make sure that, like I said, you're kind of keeping an eye on that so you can see what items to bring. And then last but not least, keep in mind we've supported Grace's Place in the past. They're looking for used blankets, afghans, all of that kind of stuff. And if you see at the bottom, Zion has already responded to that. I wanted to have a round of applause. There have been fleece fabric that has been brought in, purchased, hemmed, and then sent back out. And if you see, those are made into 26 fleece blankets. So round of applause for everyone involved there. We're a small but mighty congregation, and those, it's really cool to show up in those kinds of ways. So other than that, this is normally where we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. We're still going to do that, but you're going to have some really good music to do it too. So.
Thank you. pot instead of the sermon this morning, right? That's wonderful. One of the lights, to hear the bells, and to be together in worship. Today, of course, is Reformation Sunday. That really is the reason why we're wearing red, okay? It's not because of Ohio State. Today is a church day, and in church, whenever there's a church day, we have the pyramids in red. And this is really the celebration of the beginning. And I don't want to bore you with a story, but of course there was a time in history of the church where there were unscrupulous people who thought that they could use telling people to obey God's laws as a way of making money. And that's basically what happened when Martin Luther went to the castle church. I went there and nailed some theses on the doors to say, you got to talk about this. And of course, that's the beginning of how the, not just Lutherans, Methodists, Arianists, and Presbyterians, and a bunch of others, but how the Protestant tradition stepped forward and said, you know, faith is a gift from God. And the fact that we experience God's love, and we don't earn it. God gives it for free because he loves us and calls us to obey him and tells us, you know, that's the way that you experience God's blessing. You don't earn it, but you try to live the way God calls us to live. It's a free gift. So that's why we celebrate my work here, over here every Sunday, but when you celebrate a day like this, that's really what it's all about. And so we gather together because the Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sins and whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
And so now we welcome all of the family here and those who are watching electronically to gather together so that we can confess our faith and come to God for healing. Gracious God, have mercy on us.
We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have honored our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings of war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desires to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need. And turn us to follow the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By grace, God's unearned love and favor, you have been saved. And so in the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal blessings, I declare that your sins are forgiven.
Amen.
And may the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you. Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above, and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, gracious Lord, we thank you that your Holy Spirit renews the church in every age. Pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in times of trial. Defend them against all enemies of the gospel, and bestow on the church your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
To know the Lord means that one will defend the cause of the poor and needy. The renewed covenant is possible only because the Lord will forgive iniquity and not remember sin. Our hope lies in the God who forgets. And now the reading. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and remember their sins no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please read responsibly from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains shake in the depths of the sea.
Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage, the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord. What desolation God has brought upon the earth.
Behold, the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God. I will exalt among the nations. I will exalt in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. The second reading is taken from the book of Romans, the third chapter, verses 19 through 28. Paul's words stand at the heart of the preaching of Martin Luther and other Reformation leaders. No human beings make themselves right with God through the works of the law. We are brought into a right relationship with God through the divine activity centered in Christ's death. This act is a gift of grace that liberates us from sin and empowers our faith in Jesus Christ. And now the reading. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed, and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction. Since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, they are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By what works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise in preparation for Gospel.
Hallelujah. If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth. And the truth will make you free.
Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
In this passage for today, Jesus speaks of truth and freedom as spiritual realities known through his word. He reveals the truth that sets people free from sin. And here's the reading. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are disciples of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying, 'You will be made free'?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Little Tommy has finished his bath. Before Dad knows where he's gone, Tommy has made his way down the steps into the living room where Mom is hosting the circle for church. Instant laughter erupts as Tommy, wearing only his birthday suits, without slightest hint of any self-consciousness, makes his way across the room to where his horrified mom whisks him up and hurries him back to put his pajamas on. As all of this unfolds, you maybe think to yourselves rather sadly, you know, little Tommy will soon learn enough that society placed limits on a person's freedom. In today's Gospel from John, Jesus speaks again these words to his disciples: "You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." What did he mean by that? What is that kind of freedom? Well, we know, of course, that for some of us, maybe most of us, freedom means freedom from. Freedom from the federal government. Freedom from responsibility. freedom from traditional morality, freedom from tyrannical bosses, and freedom sometimes from nagging spouses. Remember Professor Higgins in My Fair Lady had the line, I'm an ordinary man who desires nothing more than just an ordinary chance to live exactly as I like and to do precisely what I want. You know, that's what freedom, of course, is of course, for a lot of people. They want to do exactly as they like and precisely what they want. If that means leaving behind moral restraints or social responsibilities or even those they love, so be it. People today want freedom from just about anything that would limit their personal desires. Ellie Goodman, who writes for the Boston Globe, calls us a nation of leavers. Our forefathers left Europe and Asia to emigrate to America. Next, as the frontier moved west, we left, and we moved west until we came to the ocean. And now, with no place else to go, he says we're leaving each other. This kind of freedom is very popular these days. Freedom from anything that would limit our personal autonomy. Freedom from social constraints. Freedom from crying kids. Freedom from the daily grind. Having said all of that, what would freedom be for you? Would it primarily be freedom from? Now, freedom from is not always bad. Our founding fathers and mothers came to this country to be free from political and religious oppression. Nothing wrong with that. Today, we're celebrating Reformation Sunday, recognizing, as I said, in history, that time when Martin Luther set into play forces that freed many Christians from a church that in that day was rife with corruption. Freedom from can be necessary, and it can be a noble pursuit. Have you heard about Chelsea Thomas, the little girl who was born without the ability to grin? This Palmdale, California little girl was born without the nerve that transmits commands to her facial features. This caused her, the corners of her mouth to sag. The condition Mobius syndrome afflicts about 1,000 people in the United States. A couple of years ago, however, surgeons grafted muscles and nerves taken from Chelsea's leg to the facial muscles responsible for chewing and for biting. Now, with a little thought, this blonde blue-eyed youngster can now smile. Her mom says the smile looks great. It looks very natural. She still has to work at it. It's not spontaneous yet, but it should in about a year. I ask her quite often to smile, just to see it. Now with somebody taking her picture, she does it without being asked. For Chelsea, freedom from this debilitating condition is a wonderful freedom from. So freedom from is not necessarily bad. And yet some people in exercising freedom from end up losing more freedom than they gain. particularly those who are snared with various kinds of addictions. Some people in exercising freedom from discover not happiness, but isolation, meaninglessness, and despair. Freedom from is a very complicated kind of freedom. But there's another kind of freedom that's behind all of what John is talking about in our gospel, a more exhilarating form of freedom. We call it the freedom to. For example, the freedom to be all that God created us to be. It brings to my mind at least a beautiful verse from Isaiah 40th chapter. Those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. That's a promise about freedom. The freedom to soar like eagles. The freedom to be free from our earthbound nature. The freedom to attempt what few have the nerve to attempt. Many people find their freedom and the freedom to be and do more than ordinary, the commonplace routine. Think, for instance, of the senior Olympic athletes in the news a while back. A lot of folks probably our own age. They have conditioned their bodies to respond in a way that they're able to run faster than other people their age, our age, have ever run before. To leap faster than anyone their age has ever leaped before, and at the same time to show more grace and more dignity than most of us can ever imagine. That's freedom. Most of us can tell our bodies to perform feats, and our bodies respond like that. What? You mean? You can mean? Most of us are prisoners of our own bodies, prisoners of whatever years of neglect have taken place. Of course, that's true not just of athletes. People with advanced training and ability of any kind enjoy that same kind of freedom. Some people spend their whole lives in one job and can't change no matter how much they desire because that's all they're trained to do. Others, on the other hand, keep growing and keep learning, and as a result, have the freedom to change. So there's some wisdom in this. To young people, we can say, stay in school. And for those of us who are out, which is probably all of us right now, find ways to keep on learning. For most people, education and ability equal freedom. We may think that leaving school gives us freedom from grouchy teachers, freedom from boring assignments, freedom from homework. But education and learning are actually the path to freedom. The more knowledge you have, the more and the greater your range of choices, even when you're older. For you see, freedom from and freedom to are often in conflict. And that's really what's going on in John's gospel. Sometimes we have to give up one freedom in order to gain another one. Our athletes understand this. They may have to subject themselves to grueling discipline so that they may have the greater freedom of an athletic body. Musicians understand this. I don't have a clue how they can figure out what bell to ring for, and I'm watching the music. But they spend hours practicing. Musicians like Sue spend hours practicing scales so she can play the way that she does. But the greater freedom of being able to play a hymn or a magnificent sonata is worth the priority of temporary drudgery. Scientists understand that. The hours spent mastering chemistry and physics and math pay off in the freedom to do wonderful things in the laboratory. Freedom to be all we can be means that we deny ourselves the opportunity to be free from tasks that we might find boring or unfilling. And that finally brings us to the key thought in all of this. There is freedom in spiritual things, John is telling us, that comes only from discipline and denial. How can we think that it requires discipline and hard work in other worthwhile activities, like being an athlete or a musician or a scientist, and still think that we can enjoy the fruits of God, of God's grace, without the measure of sacrifice and discipline? To be sure, God accepts us just as we are. That's the message of the Reformation. There is nothing, nothing at all in all creation that we have to do to earn God's love. He loves us. Still, without a commitment to living the Christ life, we'll never really know the joy of what that all means. I guess the question is, how much time do you spend maybe during the day in prayer or meditation or reading the Bible? After all, the Bible is the basis of everything that is the foundation of our faith in the church. How about prayer and meditation? Are we spending sufficient time reconnecting with the one who is the source of life itself? Are we leading disciplined lives morally? Wise persons, writes Colin Campbell in Leadership Magazine, have always recognized that freedom does not mean the absence of constraints or moral absolutes. Suppose a skydiver at 10,000 feet announces to the rest of the group, "I'm not using a parachute this time. I want freedom." Fact is that the skydiver is constrained by a greater law, the law of gravity. But when the skydiver chooses the constraint of the parachute, he or she enjoys a higher level of exhilaration. God's moral laws act the same way. They restrain, but they are absolutely necessary to enjoy the exhilaration of real freedom. Bible teacher Henrietta Mears knew the secret of real freedom as well. And once, while addressing some young people, she said, "A bird is free in the air. Place a bird in water, and he has lost his liberty. A fish is free in water, but leave him on the sand and he perishes. He's out of his realm." So the Christian is free when she or he does the will of God and is obedient to God's command. It's the natural realm for God's child, as natural as water for the fish and air for the bird. And so the question that John lifts up for you and for me today is, have you discovered real freedom in your life? Because Jesus said, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. The truth is Christ himself. And when we live our lives in him, the promise is that we discover a higher freedom that the rest of the world can't know. There was an article in a paper recently about an 8-year-old boy named Elmer. 5 years old earlier, Elmer's mother had moved from their home in Honduras for a job that she had in Los Angeles, in California. Elmer missed his mom so much that he set out with no money on a 2,000-mile trek to find his mom. He didn't reach her, but he did manage to hitchhike more than 1,000 miles and cross two national borders before the officials found him in Guadalajara, Mexico. Elmer, who had been living with his grandmother, persuaded truck drivers and car drivers to give him rides and food. He went to the international airport in Guadalajara, slipped past the guards, and began asking pilots of small planes for rides. Rebuffed, he asked pilots of jetliners. Officials at the airport spotted the boy and gave him food, candy, and a Mickey Mouse watch before turning him over to the City Children's Center. And until his mom came to get him. Some children run away from home in order to find freedom. Elmer knew where true freedom was. It was in the arms of his mom. We can learn that from little Elmer. Our true freedom comes not in continually running from responsibilities or running from unpleasant tasks or from social response, but running into the arms of the one who loves us with an unearned everlasting love and who gives us inner freedom from guilt and from fear and from doubt, from despair, as well as the freedom of becoming what Christ has always wanted us to be. You shall know the truth, said Jesus, and the truth shall set you free. I guess the question then is that John's asking us, wouldn't you prefer to have real freedom? The freedom found in him. In the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
merciful. You bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Please continue with words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Lord of all, we give thanks for the whole church throughout the world. Open wide the paths toward unity between denominations so that all followers of Christ may join in shared worship and mission. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
O gracious Father, when you open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. Bless the land and waters and give our world a plentiful harvest. Let your spirit go forth to renew the face of the earth. As you show us your love and kindness in the bounty of the land and sea, save us from selfish use of your gifts, so that men and women everywhere may give you thanks. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, gracious Lord, in the spirit of the Reformation, we pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon your faithful people. Keep them steadfast in your word. Protect and comfort them in the face of all temptations. Defend them against all who would harm them, and bestow on the church your saving grace through your Son, our Savior. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Comforting God, be with all who are sick, suffering, or grieving in our community and beyond. Surround them with the promise of your love, comfort, and grace that never ends. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Divine guide, you taught the hearts of your faithful people by sending them the light of your Holy Spirit. Grant that we, by your Spirit, may have a right judgment in all things and evermore rejoice in his holy counsel. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, in Christ's resurrection, you ensure that though life be wrenched away, death cannot win the day. May the truth of your saving grace through faith sustain our hope for life in you. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the saving grace you freely give, both now and forever.
Amen.
Who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Thank you.
and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you unto eternal life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, in this meal you have drawn us to your hearts and nourished us at your table with food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Now send us forth to be your people in the world and to proclaim your truth this day and evermore. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God blesses us and sends us in mission to the world. May Almighty God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.